So you're a politician in the 60s. Just like today, as a politician, your career lives and dies by the number of votes you get. Leading up to this time, nobody took out a loan to go to college. And even if you wanted to take out a loan for college, nobody was gonna lend a 17-18-year-old money when they have no job, no assets, no credit history. That would be a stupid business decision. I mean, think about it, would you lend your own money? So if you couldn't afford college, you just pick up a side job and work through school. But during the 60s, something magical was brewing. The public thought if kids could be forced to go to war in Vietnam, then it only makes sense that they should be able to vote. Meaning that the public was leaning towards allowing politicians like you to have an entirely new ripe audience to extract votes from. And to get someone to vote for you, all you have to do is to promise to solve whatever their biggest pain point is. And what is the biggest pain point for most 18-year-olds? College. So what do? You shout from the rooftops, you shouldn't have to work just to get through college? What is this, a third world country? Kids can go die in Vietnam, but you can't get an education? College is a human right, it should be affordable. You should be able to go to school and enjoy yourself. So if you vote for me, I'll make sure the government lets you get a loan. So you can enjoy your youth now, and when you're making more money, you can just pay us back. It only makes sense. So what happened? The public voted for these politicians because you wouldn't want to be anti-education now, would you? And that's what the politicians did. The government started guaranteeing student loans, which meant that if students didn't pay the loan back to the bank, the government would give the bank the money owed, which meant that student loans basically became free money for the banks, and the banks started lending to the students.
Once the colleges saw that all these kids can borrow money to go to college, well, they were like, this is great, I'm just gonna raise prices. So all of a sudden, tuition started to go up. I mean, for a long time, you can look back in the future, in history, college tuition used to be pretty stable. It didn't go up very much until the 60s.
And what started out as everyone wanting college to be more accessible has slowly snowballed into perhaps the greatest scam in history.
Education at this point is a racket. I mean, most people will never recoup the cost of a college degree.
Where instead of universities churning out educated members of society, they're churning out cold hard cash, a money-making machine not for the students or society, but for the administrators, the debtors, the politicians, the tenured professors, the board members, and their cronies.
It benefits the bureaucracy. It doesn't benefit the kids.
A trillion-dollar racket that would make the mafia proud, and Fortune 500 companies very envious of you. This is the Great American College Racket, history's greatest scam.
A higher education is the single best investment that you can make in yourselves and your future.
It's ridiculous. It is a racket.
Education is my top priority, and by supporting this budget, you'll make it yours as well.
We as a country are suckers to push it and subsidize it.
And the price you pay for it, especially in the US, is debt. And you're enticed into it because the administrators can pick your pocket.
Almost half the students who get loans don't graduate in 6 years.
Academic institutions just are fundamentally and inherently dishonest when it comes to the money.
But first, we gotta thank our sponsor. I am not against education. In fact, I think being a lifelong student is one of the most important things in life. But you wanna know what's more important? Your health. Because no matter how much money or knowledge you have, if you ruin this one sack of meat you get, you're not gonna get another one. For me, I loved eating cereal as a kid, until I found out how unhealthy it was, and how they just try to shove as much sugar and artificial stuff into it. That is where Magic Spoon comes in. They sent me a few boxes a while back, I've been eating it almost every single day, and I've blasted through 2 boxes already. It literally tastes too good to be true, that is not an exaggeration.
This is really good.
And the best part, it's got 11 grams of protein per serving with 0 grams of sugar and only 3 net carbs. You guys have got to try the coca flavor, which tastes exactly like the chocolate cereal you grew up eating, and their fruity flavor too, which is my second favorite. And you can try both of these flavors plus their frosted and blueberry flavors by picking up their variety pack today. Get it by going to magicspoon.com/JakeTran and be sure to use the promo code JakeTran to get free shipping at checkout. Magic Spoon is so confident in their product that it's backed by a 100% happiness guarantee. So if you don't like it for any reason, they'll refund you your money, no questions asked. So pause the video right now and get your variety pack at magicspoon.com/JakeTran with code JakeTran for free shipping. The link is on the screen and in the video description below. The minute students could get loans so they didn't have to pay out of pocket, colleges started jacking up their prices. After all, if you were in charge of a college, why wouldn't you? Kids had more money to spend than ever. Kids were spending money that wasn't there, so they're not gonna penny pinch as much. And after all, you have zero risk. Even if the kid drops out, the government is still gonna pay the bill. So it would be foolish not to raise tuition. If you own a restaurant and the government promised to pay all the customers' bills, why wouldn't you try to charge $1,000 for an entree? So prices started going up and it became a feeding frenzy. Every single college started competing against one another to swoop up more of this easy money from their competitors. So just like the politicians, you have to sell students on why your college is better than others, why your school deserves their vote. So how do we go about earning the vote of these potential students, earning the tuition money of these potential students? Well, these are teenagers. They're not gonna care that much about the things that are actually gonna benefit their future. Having the best teachers, curriculum, courses, no! Sure, there are gonna be some nerds out there that do care about that stuff. But for the most part, we gotta appeal to their more primal desires of having fun, lust, sloth, gluttony. So you know what they are gonna care about? Movie theaters, giant stadiums, luxury pools, luxury five-course dinners, rock climbing walls, golf courses.
600 colleges now have rock walls.
Things that will help these students escape the responsibility to postpone their transition into adulthood, to let them indulge just a little longer.
You can go to university to not be something instead of going to university to be something. And that's, it's Pleasure Island.
And that's exactly what colleges did. They started competing on who has the best amenities.
Students will come to us and say, this is what sealed the deal. It used to be reading, writing, and arithmetic. And well, we're now the fourth R, recreation.
And with more amenities, bigger campuses, bigger staffs, well, our expenses have gone through the roof. So it's only fair that we raise tuition prices even more, right? So tuition went up, higher tuition meant that even more kids were priced out of college. But fear not, college is a right, it's the best investment one could ever make. So the politicians came in again and raised the bar on how big of student loans you could get. Wow, this noble statesman really cares about us, let's vote for him again. Bigger loans meant that the customer pool for colleges grew, which means we have to compete even harder to get our customers. So more amenities, bigger campuses, bigger staffs, bigger tuition. And the beautiful cycle repeats.
More students apply to college, so schools raise tuition.
Colleges raise tuition prices at 4 times the rate of inflation.
So the loans themselves became the reason that people needed the loans, because the loans were why college was so expensive. And so now you needed a loan to go to college, but without the loan, tuition would have come down.
Which brings us to today. The lifeblood of colleges and universities are entirely dependent on the growing $1.6 trillion of student loans. Without student loans, their entire business model as it stands right now would fall flat on its feet. In 2010, those same politicians complained that it's not right that these banks are making money off the backs of students and taxpayers. So instead of guaranteeing student loans, we're just gonna issue student loans directly from the government. Or in other words, the taxpayers are now directly backing these loans. No more greedy banks. But fear not, because if you are a student shackled in debt, after a long, hard day in your first world country, you can let it all out in your campus's cry closet.
Created by art student Nemo Miller, the closet is meant to relieve the stress of finals.
Stuffed animals for comfort, lights, and of course, a timer to keep track of how long you're in there for.
But if you thought that was it for this racket, oh, you're so sadly mistaken. Let's take Rutgers University, for example. They have over 71,000 students at an average of around $18,500 in tuition each. 71,000 students times $18,500 each equals $1.3 billion in just tuition, which puts these billion-dollar companies, I mean universities like Rutgers, on the same level as companies on the Global 2000 list. But universities like Rutgers do have one advantage over these billion-dollar companies. It's that all of those billions are tax-free. Yes, universities, public and private mind you, share one thing in common with megachurches. They're both blessed by the tax man. No taxes on their real estate, tuition, sponsorships, donations, and more.
That's because the course is owned by Yale University, which has ironclad tax exemptions.
Yale is basically a money-making machine.
But before you drop everything to open up your very own billion-dollar business, I mean university, there is more. Because according to universities like Rutgers, tuition only makes up a small portion of their revenue, 30%. So not only do they not pay taxes on that inflated government-backed tuition, Education is important. Hello, state. We need more money to support the future generation. Don't be anti-education now. So they get another 20% of their revenue from the state's taxpayers in the form of state appropriations. A very cordial term for literally free money from the state government that they took from the taxpayers, which comes out to another nice $900 million. But wait, there's still more. High tuition, tax exemption, tax subsidies, that's not enough. We need more money to educate our youth. So since 2012, colleges have turned to foreign nations for foreign gifts at an estimated $12 billion.
The countries that are donating the most money to American schools are countries with terrible human rights records.
And that's just the gifts that are declared to the IRS.
Since 2012, Qatar donated $2.9 billion, China $1.2 billion, Saudi Arabia $1.1 billion.
What strings are attached to the billions of dollars that are flowing from foreign governments to American schools?
There's a great documentary out called Covert Cash that goes over all this foreign money. So, you open up your college for business, you have all this tax-free money pouring in, you can't just let it sit there and collect dust now, can you? So what should you do with all this money?
Because all we care about is getting rich.
Well, what you shouldn't do is to use all that money to lower tuition prices,
because that would make it real.
Because we gotta keep milking this house of cards for everything it's got. So what you should do is to hoard that cash and use it to start a hedge fund. Invest all that cash into assets like real estate, stocks, commodities, natural resources, private equity, and more, so that your money doesn't just sit there and depreciate in value. The problem is, if we call it a hedge fund, it would make us sound too greedy, too money hungry. The public would never allow it. So let's call it an endowment. Yes, endowments that support the teaching, research, and public service missions of the school. That sounds a lot more fancy, cordial than those dirty hedge funds.
The winners are rich colleges. Yale's endowment is $31 billion. Harvard's is even more.
Harvard could afford to pay their $50,000 a year tuition for their 6,000 students. You know for how long? Not 10 years, not 30 years, not 50 years, 120 years for free.
You can also use some of that cash to tenure professors. Tenured professors have the luxury of not being able to be fired for almost anything, unlike other plebs, short of abuse, sexual harassment, fraud, criminal activity, that kind of thing. It's a good, relaxing, honest living, like this guy that only has to teach 5 hours a week, 30 weeks per year.
You just have to teach 5 hours a week.
Well, there's people who consider that a horrible burden.
That's a scam that we're paying so much money for people like you to teach 5 hours.
Yeah, well, I'm a whistleblower.
Now critics will say, but Jake, we're in this too deep, we need student loans. Schools should get tax benefits because they're educating our youth. Endowments are important because they give schools long-term stability. And that all may be true to an extent. But when you buy almost any product, if it doesn't deliver on what it promised, you get a refund. If you buy an iPhone and it doesn't work, Apple will enthusiastically replace it or give you a refund to protect their reputation. If they don't, they'll get credit card chargebacks and lawsuits. So if the promise of a degree is that it's the ticket to success in the world, why don't colleges and universities offer a money-back guarantee if you don't get a job in your field? If this incentive was in place, everything would change in an instant. Colleges would have to immediately prioritize only the most effective degrees, the most effective professors, the most effective classes. Everything they teach would have to be relevant and up to date. They'd have to vet the students that apply with a fine-tooth comb to make sure they're serious. Potential students would have to make sure their act is together if they want to make it in, instead of enrolling to escape their responsibility. Colleges would have to help students in their job search after graduation. And colleges would have to trim off all that excess fat. The stupid degrees would go away, or maybe they'll keep them around with a disclaimer that you're not gonna get your money back if you don't land a job in your field, and all the amenities and humanities classes would either go away, or students will have to pay a separate non-refundable fee for all of it. To me, this is the biggest and only indicator you need to see just how big of a racket colleges and universities are. Now you may be saying, but Jake, this is education, this is different from a consumer product, that wouldn't be possible. Oh, but it is, and it's already happening. There are a number of coding bootcamps that offer this very land a job or your money back guarantee. And guess what? They're way cheaper, faster, relevant, up to date, they vet their students much harder, and they help students with their job search. Why? Because with colleges and universities, the incentive is to jack up prices, get you in debt, keep you entertained. Money is on the line if they don't do any of that. But with something like this, there's an incentive to be effective.
One-third of all student loan debt exceeds $100,000, and borrowers now leave school owing on average about $34,000.
Let's say you've never gone to college and don't plan on it. Why should you care about any of this? Shouldn't we just let these dumb kids suffer and drown in debt? Well, there are superficial reasons why you should care. As student loans pile up, it pours over into other areas of the economy that affect you. They can't buy cars, houses, which slows everything down. But there is a much bleaker reason why you should care. When this many young adults are shackled in debt, do you think most of them are gonna stay positive? Do you think that breeds a lot of trust in the system? In the idea that America is the land of the free when they're buried in debt? Or do you think they'll grow resentful, bitter, entitled? When average citizens feel betrayed or left behind by their own country, when the young generation, the generation that are most likely to fight in some kind of revolution or uprising because they don't have much baggage in life, feel that the system is broken, call it fear-mongering. But this is how nations fall.
But the puppet masters know all of this. They're aware. They know exactly what's taking place. They know this is unsustainable. They know they are charging an arm and a leg.
Which brings us to the next scam.
College is now so expensive, kids think they need government to afford it. And they don't realize that the only reason it's so expensive is because of government.
If you come from a family where you are making less than $125,000 a year, the family, that you in fact are able to go to a state university for free, for free.
In recent years, the next big thing politicians have screamed from the rooftops is that even though it's our fault that college is this expensive, this time it's different. We're just gonna give you free college because it's your human right. So vote for me, please. I'm kidding, they don't actually admit that it's their fault. Because much like the Federal Reserve, the government has a seemingly strong tendency to act as both the arsonist and the firefighter.
If you think education is expensive now, wait till you see how much more it costs when it's free.
So what's the solution? I'm gonna get a lot of hate for this, but I'm not a fan of straight up forgiving student loans out of thin air. Because although universities and the government have created a very perverse system, nobody pointed a gun to your head and forced you to take a loan. Nobody told you to base your decisions off of which college has the most sex appeal. I think a step in the right direction would be to let students declare bankruptcy just like any other debt and take out the consequences that come with that. But the counter argument does have a good point.
Getting people in debt for hundreds of thousands of dollars when you're 17 is crazy.
Exactly.
Your brain is, when I was 17, I was a wild person. I was barely a man. I was crazy. And for 17, 18 years old, to have a person like me and saddle them down with hundreds of thousands of dollars of debt that's gonna follow them to their grave is crazy.
Another idea would be to abolish government-backed student loans. If no one can afford college anymore because they can't get a loan, colleges would be forced to streamline.
All of a sudden, the colleges would be, oh my God, we need to cut costs. Otherwise, we'll have no customers.
But I'm not going to pretend to have all the answers. So why is the college racket possibly history's greatest scam? It has some steep competition after all. Because most scams like Ponzi schemes don't last very long. Because when you're doing more taking than giving in a relatively free society, the public eventually turns on you. But with college, the general public has been fooled for decades. But with college, even though most students know it's a ripoff going into it, even though they know they have no idea what they want to do with their life, they still sign that loan. So what do you think the solution is? Let me know in the comments below because I do try my best to read all of them. And if you enjoyed this video, do me a favor and just put in the comments I watched to the end. This will let the YouTube gods know that this video is worth recommending. It's a little thing that does really help out. If you guys pour milk in first, before the cereal, you are wrong. That's pretty good. So I know, excuse me, that this can be a rather controversial topic, sensitive topic, especially if you already paid money to college because you already like put the money in. And now you have consistency bias, which is totally fine. And on top of that, a lot of viewers of this channel and a lot of friends of mine are in college right now or have graduated college already. But hopefully you guys saw the other side of the arguments. I'm not against education. I can say with certainty that I have read more books than the average college graduate.
If you guys want to support this channel financially, you can check out our sponsor, Magic Spoon. I'm eating the fruity flavor right now, which is basically like Fruity Loops, and is definitely my second favorite flavor behind cocoa, the chocolate flavor, and it's super good. Link below. But if you are new to this channel, be sure to subscribe because we make video essays just like this one every single week on the most thought-provoking stuff in the world of business. And if you guys want behind-the-scenes stuff, day-in-the-life kind of stuff, memes, lesser-known quotes that I come across in my personal reading that I find really interesting, you can follow me on Instagram at jaketran.io. If you guys want email notifications for when new videos come out, just in case the notification bell doesn't work, as that happens sometimes, you can sign up for the email notification squad with the link below. I've been told that I chew loud. But that is going to wrap it up for this video. Thank you so much for watching. You've been awesome. I've been Jake. Stay dangerous out there, and I'll see you guys in the next one.